evening and welcome to Tinkering with Etkelar. In the second part of my reel-to-reel recorder project, I'll focus on the electrical part. If you haven't seen part 1 yet, check it out first. The electrolytics just had to go. I am a firm believer in replacing at least those. There are two output caps on the power amplifiers, the main filter cap and a supply cap for the stop solenoid that are metal can models. I found a very close replacement for the filter cap, but the others were not available in this form factor. To keep the inside at least somewhat original, I decided to recap these caps. My lathe made opening the old cans rather easy. In with the new caps, glue the stoppers in, and voila! Old, new stock, ready to mount. And now for the fun part. Since I could not find any documentation of the unit at all, I had to reverse engineer the circuitry. The power supply was easy enough. There is a shaded pole motor and a transformer, both of which have two windings which can either be in series for 220 volt or in parallel for 110. Easy enough. The secondary side has a center-tapped dual half-wave rectified solution to create DC output to feed into the main filter cap, and a central star ground point. The main mode of operation switch is a ganged coded switch with four plates, each of which has two layers and some even multiple sliders per layer. No way that I can see what these are doing by just looking in from the outside, or even clean it. That switch has to come apart like the others too. It turns out that KiCad doesn't have a symbol for this kind of switch matrix, so I had to come up with something myself. I created a symbol for a single wafer, showing the pins and a set of plates to indicate the connections per position. And after quite a bit of tracing, I had a rough idea of what each plate was doing. The front panel stuff was easy. Just a handful of wires to connect to the heads, some switches, the VU meters, and the potentiometers. I found close enough symbols for that. KiCad doesn't seem to have a symbol for tape head either. The PCBs presented some interesting challenges. While they are all single-sided and use quite easy to follow traces, some of the parts are botched on and some are missing, while others are in the wrong spot. I had several resistors that were labeled as capacitors and vice versa. To have a fighting chance, I took pictures of the front and back, flipped the backside around and overlaid them in Krita. That allowed me to connect the solder points with paint and get a clear view of which parts are connected. The sideboard turned out to be the oscillator for the erase head and a preamp for the VU meters. The power amplifier has two inputs. One is filtered through the tone control. It's a multi-stage amplifier circuit, and I think the correct English term for the final stage is a push-pull arrangement. The tape head preamps turned out to be the most complicated. Since the unit has a single head that is either play or record, the amplifier stage gets turned around too. The long slider switch changes the signal path from back to front. The second switch on the board changes a filter stage in the play path between two modes for the different speeds. Speaking of adjustments, there is a combined trimmer inductor stage on the mode switch. Turns out that this is a ballast that simulates a second erase head whenever the unit is in mono mode. while I rebuilt the mode switch, I discovered that I lost one of the distance pieces. Darn. If only I had a lathe to make a replacement. Oh, wait a second. After soldering in all the new capacitors and switches, I was ready for the first system test. Power on, and whoops, I didn't catch it on camera, but there was quite a beefy smoke cloud coming from the right power amplifier stage. Turns out that the heat sinks for the power transistors need insulated washers. I shorted one of the resistors to ground and it burned off its skin. Whoopsie, but it still works. So here we go with the adjustments. Starting with the power amplifier, adjusting the bias on these transistors so that the transition from one to the other is smooth while not drawing excess current. The other trimmer sets the DC offset. I set it to about mid-supply voltage. For the phantom erase head, I made sure that the signal that arrives at the erase head is the same in stereo and in mono mode. Since I have no spectrum analyzer, I had to make do with a software-based solution. Good enough, I think. I'm still not 100% sure how the filter stage works, but it turns out that it adjusts the upper frequency response of the playback for each speed via the trimmers. One trimmer per speed and channel at around 13 and 18 kHz respectively. Adjusting the record signal was tricky. Note that I have no idea if they are good in absolute terms, as I lack some equipment to measure this stuff. But I am sure I am close enough. I recorded a stereo sine wave in one direction and noise in the other direction. Both came out clear and no crosstalk was noticeable, so I assume that the two heads are running on track. The erase signal, a 60 kHz sine, is coupled to the record head via two trimmer capacitors. I tweaked it to get the voltage level that gave me a clean recording of my test signal and adjusted the VU meters to show red whenever the recorded signal would start to clip. The motor is getting a tad bit hot, about 60 to 65 degrees centigrade over longer periods of operation. Nothing I can do about that, I'm afraid. I did pour in some glue between the laminated sheets to reduce the hum, though. Now that everything is working, let's put in the last screws and button up the case. One last try. Yikes! Why is that thing smoking again? Ow! The transformer got incredibly hot. My infrared thermometer showed over 90 degrees centigrade on the surface. After it cooled down a bit, I discovered that the last screw I put in has pinched the secondary windings. So I shorted out one of the outputs. No wonder it got hot. But now the winding is damaged. Now I remember the closed screw when I disassembled it. I did try to fix the transformer by soldering the windings together again. But since I have no tool to tension the core, it hums like there is no tomorrow. Another spare part. I decided to also change the incandescent bulbs for LEDs. 5 mA instead of 40 mA per lamp will make it easier for the new transformer. Here's a brief rundown on how things connect. The main switch turns on the power, selects the filter stage on the boards, and connects the motor to the flywheel via a rubber idler. The speed selection uses one of two diameters on the motor side, so the motor can run at the same speed for both. The play button pushes the pinch roller against the capstan, which is the flywheel axle, and also pushes the tape against the head, while simultaneously bringing another idler wheel against the flywheel and the pickup wheel, while also removing the brakes from both wheels. The pause button will disengage the pinch roller and engage the brake on the source wheel. The pickup wheel keeps running, so the tension on the tape is maintained. Fast forward and reverse are locked out mechanically when the play operation is active. When they are selected, the brakes are disengaged on the receiving end and tension is kept on the source end. The rotation is transferred via the drive belt from the motor to an idler wheel combo that either drives the left or the right wheel depending on the direction. When the record button is pressed, the switches on the tape board get shifted over. In mono mode, only one board is active, for stereo, both will engage. The case got a bit of polish. Sadly, I could not remove all the scuff marks, but it is nicer now than it was before, at least. I removed a few things in the metal plating and replaced the backing, which was warping and brushing against the tapes. Now to the side panels. I cut up cheap cushion covers for some fabric and bent wires for support. Add a bit of glue and trim, voila, instant speaker cover. To connect the new side panels to the case, I used brass screws for that special look. Upon closer inspection of the old panels, what I thought was chemical spill might have been glue residue where some bezel has come off. Finally, a musical test is called for. Setting up, getting ready, go! We'll be right back. that's it. Apart from the tractor, this has been my biggest project so far. I have lots of footage and had to cut out quite a bit to keep things moving. I might do a director's cut at some time if people are interested. Thanks for watching. See you next time. The play button pushes the pinch roller against the capstan, which is the flywheel axle, and also pushes the tape. Yay! Freedom for tapes!